Welcome to our Amphitheater Hot Shop. I'm going to take a second here and introduce the team. So I want to welcome you all here at the museum and welcome our live streamers watching from all around the world. But the man of the hour is Darin Denison. Let's give him a nice welcome. Nice. Thank you. We have a lot of people on the stage. I'll go from left to right. We have Kat Burns, Aaron Jack. Yeah, thank you. Frederick Van Atta. And George Kennard. Yeah. My name is Heather. I'm out here. I'm here to assist you. If you have any questions from the crowd, feel free to raise your hand. Get my attention, and that goes for the live streamers too. We've got Amanda watching your comments. If she can't answer it, I will do my best to answer your questions. All right, so Darin is going to make an object. It's from his Lek series. So these are reminiscent of bird forms, and they speak towards body language. That's what we chatted a little bit before the show. But you can check these out online. We have a little page about Darin on our cmog.org, and these are some of the pictures and a form that he's been known to make. Now he's going to start off, looks like he's picking up some color, I believe, must be. We have a garage over here. This garage is 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit on one side, a little cooler going down. Now he has picked up some color bar, and this will become a component or a layer of color throughout the vessel. Has everybody seen a demonstration today? Yes. Who has never seen glass blowing before? Anyone out there? Okay, a few of you. Kat, it's your first day. Prepare to be amazed. She's really nervous. She's going to look like a natural. Okay. I know Darin has been making glass for a while. George has been making glass for about 30 years. I believe, Darin, how long have you been blowing glass? 22 years. And you've lived in Seattle for that long, but traveled all over, right? 25 years in Seattle. Taught in Seattle, studio trained. So a lot of experience up here. I know Kat has lived and worked around Corning for at least 5 years. Aaron Jack has lived in Corning his entire life and has a lot of experience as well. Never left. Well, he did go to Bowling Green for a little bit, so it counts. All right. So Darin has color. He has a chunk of white bar. I can see that is quite a bit of color. Darin knows from his experience just how much color bar he wants and needs in order to have a nice saturated layer of color. So we have many different ways to colorize pieces of glass. We have bar, we have frit, and there's even powdered glass. So we can use all these different ways to put color into the glass to get different textures, to get different hues. We can even use colored glass to get lines, squares, you name it. The options and the ability for glass color, they're endless. You can make anything out of glass. You can put any pattern into glass. It really is an amazing material. So we switch over to use bar so that it's very, very dense. Frit and powder, when you put them onto glass, they give you a veil or even polka dots in the glass. This frit, or this bar, will be a nice line down the front of Darin's piece. So we are making a piece that is reminiscent of a bird. Actually, Kat has taken a moment here and drawn the form on our whiteboard. I don't know if you can pull that up on the AV and see what we're making here later tonight, but we'll put that online for our viewers streaming as well. There it is. So that's what he's making. Or this is the Lek series, L-E-K. And it's reminiscent of a bird, not any particular bird. Darin says that a lot of people call it a penguin, but I think that's probably because of the white belly and black back. Right. Any questions from the crowd so far? We have a longer time frame for this, so there are no time constraints because It's the final show of the day, the late show, the last show, the best show, because we have Darin here. All right. All right. So color application tends to be the longest part of making any piece. You know, you can put lines into the glass by using cane or even Marini. Darren's melting this white bar down so that he can come back and use it for a piece. Looks like George has picked up black. So there's a big chemistry behind glass. We don't make our own glass here at Corning Museum of Glass. We simply remelt it. We order our color from a company called Reichenbach. They're based out of Germany. They've been making colored glass for almost 200 years. A little bit over. Yeah, question. Perfect. Yeah, what is glass actually made of? Not a silly question, because I'm sure not a lot of people know. Our glass, right now we're using spectrum. So there are three main ingredients: silica, soda ash, and limestone. I'm going to go ahead and pass these around. They are the raw ingredients that the company gets. They melt it down and they send us glass ingots. So it looks like flour, doesn't it? Yep, I'll hand this to you and you can pass them down. Keep the lids on them. If you spill them, you pick up every single piece, every particle. Yep. Yep, they're melted down. I'll send this around too. This is the chips of glass that we throw right into the furnace door. They look like ice cubes, don't they? Yeah. There you go, we'll send that down. This is glass. Yep, so we melt cullet. That's from those three. Yep, they melt it down. Our clear glass is made out of about 70% silica, about 20% soda ash, and about 10% of that limestone. So pure silica melts above 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit. Our center furnace is running at 2,100 degrees Fahrenheit. The reason it can melt the glass is because of the soda ash. That acts as a flux, lowers the temperature which we can melt the silica. Then we have to add limestone that acts as a binder. It holds everything together. If you don't add enough binder, the glass becomes water soluble. It'll end up breaking down over time. A lot of the pieces in our collection that are over 3,000 years old, they are breaking down because people didn't know about that side of chemistry. They weren't adding enough of that binder. So it would degrade over time. Some of it has an iridized sheen on it, but that's because the light enters the glass and it refracts back to your eye through those many, many layers of the glass falling down. I'm sorry, falling apart. So colored glass then. Colored glass, like the colors that Darin is using, Reichenbach adds different metallic compounds. These are in the form of oxides, sulfides, chlorides, carbonates. I am not a chemist, so I will not claim to know the exact recipe for every single color. But if you have a favorite color and you need to know what metal makes it, I can answer to the best of my ability. I know that greens can come from chromium, iron, potassium. Reds can come from gold chloride. Blues from copper and cobalt. They're very, very similar to ceramic glazes. Not sure if anyone's played around with paints too. You know, you have titanium white, cadmium yellow. Titanium makes our white. Cadmium can go in to make yellow as well. Now Darin has switched over. He's gone to a blowpipe. So they're going to start to decorate the glass and use these different bars of color. He's quenched the end of the blowpipe. So this gets the pipe just the right temperature. Any metal flecks will fall off into the water. This helps ensure that he gets a clean gather. We use an electric pipe warmer, but sometimes if there's any organic material, like maybe some of the paper gets into our break-off bucket, or you know, can build up carbon on the end of the blowpipe. And if you gather on top of that, you'll get a bubble in the glass. So we don't want that. We want a nice, clean gather, which, that's a pretty clean gather there, Darin. Yes, very nice. It's a great shot. You know, we have a wonderful AV team up here, too. They'll do a great job at following the action. We have a view into the back of our furnace, which I have, I'll admit, I've become very spoiled with that view. Not a lot of glassblowers get it, so I'll find myself staring at that and my piece as we're working along. There's, as this piece gets larger and larger, some of you, especially in this kind of central section, can look through the furnace and see the little window of glass in the back. So there's a window, and a camera looks through that window. The window doesn't melt because it's made out of fused silica, a very pure and simple form of glass that melts at around a little over 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit. So that fused silica was invented here in Corning in the 1930s. Today it's used in some spacecraft shuttle windows and optical fiber, so it's the core of optical fiber. Now Darin has started a bubble. He did that by trapping a breath of air in the blowpipe. This pressurizes the air that was already in the pipe. That pressurized air has nowhere else to go but rise up into the soft glass. Yeah. Yeah. So the pipes are made out of stainless steel. Let's watch here for a second, though. Darin is going to drop colored glass onto this bubble. This is a color overlay, depending on what part of the world you're from. It can also be an underlay. So Kat is getting the white glass hot. The bubble Darin is working with is cold to a glass blower. 900 degrees Fahrenheit is cold. You'll be able to push this white glass around that core bubble. Okay, so temperature difference. So a skilled glassmaker will use these temperature differences to their advantage. Cold glass being rigid, hot glass being malleable and moving. I have a blowpipe here, right? It is made out of stainless steel. Are there any brave souls who'd like to try and be a glassblower for a second? She jumped right up. No? Oh, she's probably I scared her. If you would like to try holding a blowpipe, you can come on right down. This is the size blowpipe that Darin is using. So it's stainless steel. We've got a rubber grip on the back. It is hollow like a drinking straw. So he'll blow through one end and inflate the hot glass at the other. If we look closely at the pipe, you can see it has this tarnished. I know this is cold. I picked it up from the cold rack on purpose. The tarnished zone we call the hospital zone. Darin will not grab into it unless he knows it's been cooled. So we have a piece of equipment up here called a pipe cooler. It's kind of like a fancy drinking fountain. It's pump action. So we pump with our foot. It shoots water up onto the pipe and cools it down. So he can use that as the piece starts getting larger and larger. The closer he can hold up to the glass, the more control he has over it. So if you're holding the pipe way back here, right, it gets really, really heavy and you can't support the weight and it becomes very hard to turn. So Darin will always turn, probably most of the time. It looks like this becomes a pretty sculptural object at the end. This one is about, it's no more than 10 pounds. It's pretty heavy already. Yeah, it's, and he's turning that, yeah, and it's a pretty wide stance, so turning both directions, right? Yeah, it's pretty heavy. You wanna try being a glass blower? Come here, come on. Here. Future glass blower of America. Ready? Turn around. Turn around. Face your dad. There you go. Here you go. It's not that heavy. You try it out one day. There you go. One more time. The piece that George has, so if we look at the whiteboard over here that Darin has drawn, or Kat drew, of Darren's pieces that he likes to make, we have an underlay or overlay of a white body, and George has, they're going to apply this so that this lek, this bird-like figure is going to have a black back, right? So they're going to layer this up. I've actually not seen Darin make one of these before. Nobody has. This is top secret. I have to swear everybody in. This is confidential. No one's seen him make it. So they'll apply this together so that he's going to have the white exposed on one side and then a black back to the other. He's making sure there's a bubble still in there. Pretty important, smushing for lack of a better term. That white glass over the cold bubble can cause the bubble to collapse. It becomes very difficult to restart a bubble in the material. So George does have black glass. You know, you can really see the temperature difference in the black glass versus the white glass. We'll notice that the black glass really appears orange when it's close to 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit, but the white doesn't. The white is a fairly stubborn color. It doesn't go through a lot of color changes with temperature change. It reflects a lot of the light energy that's inside of the furnace. When we talk about black and white glass, we talk about them as stiff or soft. Black glasses, they stay hotter for longer. They move around longer because they absorb a lot of that heat faster and for a longer amount of time. The white will reflect it. So it's very similar to you wearing a white or a black shirt on a hot summer day. Which one are you going to feel hotter in? Black, yeah. So our colors, they do that as well. So when Darin starts to get this larger and larger, you might see how the glass moves differently depending on if it's white or black. Okay, so question was, hi Richard, what chemicals or metals make white or black? Again, I'm not going to claim that I know the exact recipe because I am just a glassblower. I've been told that tin, titanium, antimony, and then fluorine, makes the glass opaque. Okay, the black colored glass, there is no true black. Nowhere, not even an obsidian. Okay, different obsidians in the world have different colors depending on what region and where they came from. I've seen green obsidian, I've seen rainbow blue obsidian, and it all depends on how, of course, thin the flake is of that rock. I've been told that black is like a kitchen sink of very heavy metals, like cobalt, iron, manganese. A lot of our blacks, if we blow them out very, very thin, will appear purple because of the amount of manganese that's in it. So really, we're just trying to stop the light from reflecting back any one color. It kind of just absorbs it. Yeah. Yeah, so George did an overlay as well. So they rolled that black colored glass over a bubble. And now George is gathering more glass. Maybe we could roll that animation of gathering, just because we've seen it a couple times now. So this is a really cool animation as well. A cutout of our furnace. A lot of people have asked me if the glass is inside the furnace, is it floating around like cotton candy? Do you poke it up on different shelves? But it's just like honey. It sits in the bottom of the furnace like honey sits in the bottom of a jar. So we take cold glass, push it into the surface of the hot glass, turn in one direction, and it spools up and around itself just like honey would on the end of a honey dipper. Very tricky to learn how to do. If we look at Darin's setup, you'll notice that the gather line is straight. Right? A beginning glass blower, when you walk up to the furnace, it's pretty intimidating. It's 2,100 degrees Fahrenheit. They're not quite sure on how to look at the level of the glass. So it's kind of like looking at a pool of water. You can see a reflection back up at yourself. Except when you look into a furnace, that pool of water is bright orange and it's extremely hot. So a beginner's gather will have kind of a high side to a low side because they haven't made a full turn inside of the furnace. All right. Oh, the COE of this glass, 96. That I know. These are premium nuggets from Spectrum. Yes, it's premium. We are very spoiled here for a lot of reasons. We're working in a state-of-the-art hot shop. The Spectrum premium nuggets, I like working with the thicker it gets. You know, sometimes different clear glasses will have a tinge of green or even purple, blue. The Spectrum is pretty clear. It's the clearest soda lime glass that I've ever come across. It's really nice. It has a long working time. So this glass is designed for glass artists to use. If you tried making a piece of glass with melted soda pop bottles, those pop bottles, they were engineered, the glass was engineered to shoot up into a mold and freeze in place. So the working time is very short. Why do a strip gather into the bucket of water rather than the furnace itself? So we just saw them drop a little bit of clear glass into our bucket. We call that a strip gather. When we're inside of our furnace, sure, we can decide about how much glass to pick up. If the level of the furnace is high, we cannot allow so much glass to fall back into the furnace. You have to come out of the furnace, tip the bubble down, and allow that glass to fall off. Because Darin only, or George, wanted a certain amount of glass, he did not take it all. It might be very, very difficult to put that glass back into the furnace itself. So you can control how much glass you get by how fast or slow you turn inside of the furnace, how fast you follow that trail, how much glass you want to scoop up or pick up. But if you get too much, you strip it off into the bucket here. All right. So they're puntying the piece. This is going to give Darin access to the inside of the bubble. Yeah, you can give him a round of applause. Yes. You say, one step down. Maybe that must have been a couple steps by now, but oh yeah. No, it's going to go perfectly, Darin. You're doing great. That's good. George is probably going to do the same thing. They're going to join these bubbles to create the pattern. George is doing a similar thing. Yep. Yeah, you can. I will not talk the entire time. If you do have questions, it is kind of nice to listen to the music, sit back, relax, and listen to the glass blowers talk. Especially when this piece gets larger and more intense, I will most likely, definitely, jump back onto the hot shop floor and help out, kind of just let you all appreciate how we work together traditionally. Yeah. Thank you. Yep. The open flame, yep. Yeah, so the open flame is a propane torch. There's a lot of uses for that tool. I've seen it used to preheat. So the jacks, for instance, that's the tool in Darin's hand right now. You can use that propane torch to preheat the blades of the jacks and then run them through beeswax. So we put beeswax on the jacks, mostly just the jacks. I've seen people put it on the tag, which is a metal spatula-looking tool. But if that beeswax gets on, say, the tips of the tweezers, it becomes impossible to pull on the glass with the tweezers because you just simply slip right off from the beeswax. So you can use the propane torch to clean tools as well. We will see Darin using that to maintain temperature in the piece when it starts to get larger and larger, so he can hit the glass with that propane torch where he wants it to be hotter. When we're looking at Darin work, you know, the first amount of glass into the furnace will always be the hottest. It is getting the most amount of heat. Whatever is closer to the glass blower on the pipe itself is going to be the coldest. It's getting the least amount of heat. It's in the furnace for the least amount of time, and that stainless steel acts as a heat sink. So it is pulling heat away from the glass. We'll watch Darin. He'll use that propane torch to work heat back into the back of the piece. Or you can heat the glass wherever he wants it to move with that torch. Our furnaces down here are natural gas and forced air. They're combustion. In fact, when Darren's piece gets larger, when the select gets larger, and he's inside of the furnace, you may be able to see where those burners are. They're only on one side. They're slightly pointed down, so you get kind of a vortex of heat. Inside of the furnace as well, there is a nice wall. There's a definitive wall of heat where that burner is. So Darin can pick how deep he heats into the furnace depending on where he wants that heat line to go. So we've got another punty happening over here, another transfer with George and Aaron. This is really nice to see two benches working. This is a special punty. Looks like a sculptural punty. A little bit is going to be left off the end of it. The punty is hot enough to hold on, but cold enough to break free, exactly where George put that constriction. With that shot, you can really see how the glass breaks. All right, so there is a lot going on. Darin, do you encomo these together? Is that what you're going for? Yep. Switch. Three gathers. Okay. So we have a few pieces up here that will help me explain Darin's process. Can everyone see these two bottles up here? We have separate bands of color and pattern. This is called encomo. So we're going to take these two bubbles, or two cups now, and join them lip to lip. We'll have a black hemisphere and a white hemisphere. Then he's going to take another blowpipe and stick it in between the two hemispheres and flip the axis. So you can take two kind of side-by-side bands of glass and flip them vertical. Then Darin is going to take three gathers. So three dips of glass out of our furnace. Now the gathers are going to get larger and larger. They'll pick up more and more glass each gather because there's going to be more surface area from each gather. So this piece will get fairly large. I have watched Darin work a lot throughout the years, and I know he can handle a lot of glass. He makes larger stuff. He's an integral part of Lino Tagliapietra's team, so he travels around the world. He's self-employed. He works for himself as an assistant and a glass artist or craftsman. So a really successful artist that we have here this summer. It is a treat to watch him work out of our Amphitheater Hot Shop. So there's that propane torch heating up the punty, making sure it's warm enough to stick. And we've got George over here. He's working on the lip of the black part. Now, everything for this encomo process has to be just right. Darin, do you take a measurement or you just eyeball it? Just eyeball it. With your ears? You gotta listen to the glass. And then you stick it with your ears. Now, this is a master glassblower up here. He uses every part of his body. Everything. I think that's why a lot of us love glass, because you do have to use everything. It is. All right, so George has that open. That was a really great view by the AV team. You could see the band of color on the inside of the bubble. The white, not so much. It's really hard to see the difference just because it's all pretty much the same color. The light kind of plays a trick with your eye. All right, so sometimes glassblowers will use calipers or different tools to measure the opening of the piece. These two openings have to be exactly the same size. You know, you don't want one cup to encompass the other and get kind of a wavy seam. We don't want one cup too small either, because obviously you'll stick it right into the other. Here we go. Oh, he's going to go for it. Oh, price check. Just kidding. So you're going to switch. So, hey, me? Yep. Okay. Yeah, makes sense. Makes a lot of sense. Yeah. You're thinking. Yeah, the brain is working too. Brain is important. So what he's talking about is he is going to break the white cup off onto the black cup. This will make it so that the white is the first thing into the furnace and the last thing out. It's going to get the most amount of heat. This will allow that black cup in the back to set up. It'll be stable, especially since this is going to be closed off for a little bit. If that black starts to reheat, since it's in a vacuum, you know, that air is going to start to move from the temperature. You could blow out that black cup. So very, very smart, using the noggin. Making sure temperatures, these are things that a master glass blower thinks about. I know when people are starting to learn, they think, oh, blue and white glass, they look so good together. But then they realize that the blue moves around for a lot longer than the white colored glass. And before you know it, you have a sculpture instead of maybe a nice little bowl you were trying to go for. All right, so we'll watch this part. Whoa. I might punch you that one more time. All right. So Darin did that on purpose. He's gonna switch it around. Maybe, we'll see what he does. Yep, he'll switch it around. So it is very important that the white is in the front of the piece. You can also fix up that seam if he feels like it wasn't perfect, but yep, that's newspaper. Not just any newspaper. The Corning Leader. Yep, we're all local. We support our local community. It's organic. How come it doesn't get your hands hot? Well, the newspaper is soaked in Corning tap water. So another very important ingredient here. That water acts as a barrier of steam. So the glass is so hot, and yes, we only use the newspaper at certain temperatures. Sometimes if there's too much water on a newspaper and you touch the glass when it's too cold, you'll cause crizzling from that water. But I've got one right here, in case you didn't believe me. I'm not responsible for any carbon that you get on your hand. Yep. Yeah, you can pass that around too if you want. I mean, we've got plenty of newspaper. I don't know what's going to happen when they stop printing newspaper. Yeah. That's one of my favorite things about being a glassblower. You know, you know when you've worked for a full day in the hot shop. You come back smelling like campfire. You're probably a little dirty, which is fine, but you can feel it in your hands. It takes your entire body, like we were saying, to work with the glass. So here's the punty. They are transferring it. This will make that connection a little stronger as well, because it's a fresh punty. So he'll break that free. Remember, this is a closed bubble right now. So they will end up having to pick a hole. Darin could use hot glass to do that. There it goes. Yeah, let's give him a nice round of applause. Yeah. So now he can start to clean it up, shape it up. He'll start shaping it into the form that he wants to gather on. It can be an orb. It could be more of a torpedo shape. But he will end up having to pick a hole wherever he wants the next blowpipe to go. We're still in color application mode right now, believe it or not. So he'll pick open a hole and attach a blowpipe to it, like the blowpipe that I had out here. Actually, the blowpipe that they're going to use might be larger than the blowpipe that I had out earlier. So we have all different types of pipes and rods to accommodate different amounts of glass. We have a larger pipe than this. Kat is holding a high-power torch. So this is what they can use to pick open the hole. I'm going to show you the largest pipe that we have here. This is not what Darin is using. I just think it's a monster. So I will show it to you. This pipe, you can, I don't know, can anyone see that it's square up here? You can attach a wheel to it. So you start driving it instead of turning it. Right. So it's a... Yeah, opalescent glass, that is, that's a really tricky one. I think that glass is so finicky too. Again, I'm semi-versed in the chemistry of glass. But opalescent glass, you know, there's a artist named Mark Pizer out there, and he does a lot of casting that's influenced by the polymer telescope we have here in the museum. And I remember listening to him talk once about making his own opalescence glass. And depending on what temperature he heated up to, or, you know, just varying degrees, he could mix the same metals into the same batch, but heat them in different kilns or annealers. If any temperature was different, he might get an amber opalescence glass or a blue one. Opalescence glass, just, I wish I was more well-versed in it. I would suggest, you know, we have a wonderful resource online. All of you that are here, we have the Raycow Research Library that's behind the studio here. Your red tags get you in for 2 days. So here we've, you know, Corning Museum of Glass is one of the best museums in New York. You get the Welcome Center, free parking. Your tags get you in for 2 days. Children are free. We have wonderful membership services as well. But the Raycow Research Library, if you go online, they have Ask a Librarian. If I can't answer it, the librarian will research it for you and find an answer to that question. So I would suggest that. Opalescence glass. I'm not quite sure. Yeah, tricky question. I like the ones that stump me, so it means I have to go do some research, too. Yeah. What's it supposed to be? So can you see the whiteboard on the far end? It looks a little bit like a bird, the drawing down there. So it's a vase that looks like a bird, I guess, is the best answer. It's called a lek. That is what a series that Darin is working on. And it really has to do, he said, with body language. So you know how birds communicate with their, you know, they strut their stuff, the plumage goes up, means, hey, I like you a lot. All right, humans do the same exact thing. We have a lot of subliminal body language that we go through. So each one of these pieces has its own body language. Oh, this is something that interests Darin. Cat with two torches. Look at that. I'm a fan of two torches. It's a... So it looks like Kat is heating up the seam while Darin is blocking. So these torches, what they're doing is they're heating up the surface of the glass. They'll remove any texture, any kind of valley that occurs from joining the two cups together. It'll make it a perfectly smooth surface. Now that air is trapped on the inside too, so it is pushing out while Darin is pushing in. Any seam that's left between the two cups joining will pick up an air bubble when they go to gather. Not something that Darin wants in this piece of glass. There are artists out there that like bubbles in their glass. It's a, you can see it, yeah. It's a sign of the handmade process. There's ways to get uniform bubbles into a piece by dropping it into a mold or using different canes of glass and layering them. But for this piece, no bubbles, except for the one that's on the inside. Yeah, I see. Question? What class? Like, how do you learn? Yeah. You know, each glassblower has a different story on how they became a glassblower or exposed to this world. There's about 40 to 50 different colleges in the United States that offer glassblowing. You could be exposed to it from a young age. You could be a local to either Corning or Seattle. I'll get a little bit of Darin's story here now that he's not, when he's not focusing, using his whole body. There. Yeah, the newspaper, it can smooth, but it's as close as shaping the glass with your hand that we'll ever get. So, you know, a ceramicist can play with the clay, move it around, add water if it gets too dry, you know, do it physically with their hands. There are tools to assist them, but for us, we need extensions of our fingertips or we'll get burnt, right? I've seen glassblowers touch the glass. As long as you're fast enough, you're not going to burn yourself. I don't like to do it, just because I prefer to use the proper tool. I've seen glassblowers use a fresh gather of glass to get a splinter of glass out of their finger. But as long as you're fast enough, you're only burning the protective layer of oil that you have on your skin. So this is why we don't touch anything in the museum, right? We all have oil on our fingertips. That oil can get on the glass. Some of our pieces are nearly impossible to clean. But if you're fast enough, that's the only thing that leaves. Now here they go, they're poking that opening. I will figure out what more about Darin here. We are sitting in the old Steuben factory though. So this used to be a factory floor with guys working. You know, a lot of people remember coming here 10, 15 years ago, walking around the same catwalk and watching Steuben workers work and make their glass. We've kept the spirit alive of glassmaking here in the amphitheater, but to give you an idea of how long it takes to become a master glassblower or to be proficient in the material, Steuben had an apprenticeship of 6 years or 12,000 man hours before you could sit at the bench and call yourself a gaffer, which is what Darin is for our live stream, right? He is the leader or the foreman of the project, and that's what where the term gaffer is. All right, so a torch really comes in handy. You can fix it all up and just really need to make sure that there is a hole to attach a blowpipe to. Which he's going to get. So Darin is going to pick up a little bit of clear glass and create a collar, like a collar on your shirt. It'll just be a clear amount of glass around the very end of the blowpipe. Nope. Just waving. Okay. Did we practice this before we're doing this on a live stream in front of the entire world? No. This is not Darin's first luck, but this is the first time that this team has ever been assembled together. It's going to look like we have done this before, but that's because we all have a very high level of expertise. We're all professional glassblowers. No one on this stage has been blowing glass for less than 6 years. So very important to have a knowledgeable team on your side. I know a lot of glassblowers like to come out to Corning Museum of Glass because they can always trust in our team and our capabilities to help them make whatever they need to make. So it is a really great team that we have here at the museum. Darin, where were you first exposed to glass? Where were you first exposed to glass? Seattle. Yep. Where's your first job? Yep. Well, we'll do paid for the people.
It was with Dale.
With Dale? Yeah. You worked at the boathouse?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. All right. Well, I'll let Darin concentrate. We're all going to watch this pretty intense moment. And he has it. Observing it, but also letting it fall onto the blowpipe, right? Watching to make sure that that is sealed. I'm just going to remove that little bit of clear glass off the ends of the bubble. I think it's becoming more apparent how they've gotten the color, the white front and the black back. Yeah, what's your question? Is that the belly? Yeah, the white part is the belly. Yeah, the black part's gonna be the back. So the great thing about making a bubble is if you can make a bubble like Darin has. Darin can turn this into anything. He could turn it into a dinosaur if he wanted to. But it is going, he decided before the show that he wanted to make one of these bird figures. Yeah. One more time? Yeah, come on down. Yeah, sure. Well, this one is bigger than the other one that I had out. So did you stretch before? No? Wow, that's a heavy one, huh?
Yeah.
Now you had to turn it, too. Let's see. Whoa, it's heavy. Almost gotcha. That is heavy, isn't it? Well, that's why you can put a wheel on the end of this, and then you can put it on a special cart that wheels it around, and you turn it. It would make it a lot easier, wouldn't it? You're welcome. I've seen we always get asked questions about gloves, right? Why aren't we wearing gloves up here? Darin asked before the show for a right-handed glove. He's going to be pulling points, so his right hand specifically will be very close to the heat. I've seen some glass blowers put on gloves to help with turning. So these look like batter's gloves. They're really tight leather gloves. When the piece gets larger and larger, I think it's apparent that you might get sweatier and sweatier, or glisten. Darin's going to glisten, right? But that can make holding onto the pipe and turning it pretty slippery. So by putting these gloves on, it'll give a little more leverage, a little more turning capability on the pipe. I don't know. I won't give away Darin's secret, what you wash your hands with. He said it, so I'll repeat it. Darin washes his hands in batch, which is raw glass. He's one with the material. He's slowly going to become glass. That'll give him a good grip on turning the pipe. And like that is an old trick. Sure. Where did you learn that, or did you just invent it? Uh-huh. Dino Rosine was your first teacher at Pilchuck in 1998. Yep, that was a good year. Diego and Paula. Yeah. Every morning, they're washing their hands with raw batch. So Darin has picked this up from his first glassblower, 1998. You saw it here first, though, at Corning Museum of Glass. Yeah. And we'll see larger and larger blocks being used. I know we pulled up a fairly large one for Darin to roll the glass into. Can you see, though, how that black hemisphere looks larger? Right? It's because the black is moving still, and he's slowly pushing onto to the white. So it will slightly inflate on its own because of the vacuum that's created from the closed-off orb. All right, so we're getting ready to gather here. Is this Darin's class all up here? No? It looks, we got some glass blowers up there. That is one of the best seats in the house, though. Don't feel like your glute, I know the suspense will get larger and larger, but don't feel like you're glued to your seats. You can walk around. I know a lot of glass blowers will sit up on the catwalk there, so you get a bird's eye view of things that are happening. Again, another thing that you don't get normally. It's a good view. The peanut gallery, too. Yeah. Well, look at that. What a great shot. You're all famous. Yeah, this is really, truly a great spot to make glass in. You've got views all around. We've got the view into the back of the furnace. There is air conditioning that comes up from the ground, which is very, very nice in the summer. And when pieces start to get larger and larger, you know, it gets hotter and hotter in the shop, so this air conditioning becomes very nice. We have torch hookups across the board. We even, you know, all these bleachers can get pushed back. It opens up the entire space, and we have gas hookups on either side. So this entire place can be turned back into a factory if we needed it to be. It's something, I don't know, I would love to see, you know, get it truly back to its spirit. But, you know, there's so much going on here, so much that we can do. We can make anything out of this hot shop. Yeah. Yeah, no, that indentation is from where the punty broke free. So it's missing a little bit of material. Or he pushed, I wasn't watching. Did he push the? Darin, that dent, is it a dent or is it just clear glass? Yeah. Yeah. It's the back of the head. Oh, the magnification. Yeah. So it does look like a dent from the screens, but looking at it closer, when he tilts it side to side, there is no dent. It's magnification of the glass. Thank you. Thanks for that pointer. I couldn't quite see it from here. But you can see it, right? See when it's underneath? There is no actual dent in. It's the magnifying of the glass itself. Yeah, it'll disappear. You won't see that. The texture will go. So here we go. We're going to start. Eyeballing the blocks, making sure it is the right one. Here's the pipe cooler. There we go. Cooling it down before it goes into the furnace. All right, here we go. Another layer of glass. Notice how slow he turns at first. Now, strip gather at this point is nice because it will even the form. It pulls all of that glass down towards the tip of the bubble. Gathering on a rounder form like this, sometimes you can get what glass blowers refer to as dog ears. So the glass will spread out in the middle of that bubble because it's an orb, and you get kind of these two masses of glass from that gather. So by stripping the glass off, it pulls all of that into an even layer, shaping the glass without touching it with one of the tools. Oh, we've got our stairs out. Is that for the annealer? So right now that white looks pretty orange, and that's because the fresh heat from that gather. The glass, you can't really ever get it as hot as when you pull it out of the furnace, out of the melting furnace. That is when you're going to have the most amount of heat. I've always been told it's been pretty important to get a lot of the shaping done with that heat. Don't let the glass get too cold, because you're going to work harder in the end. I've always been told to work hotter, not harder. I've got one question here real quick, and then. What is Darin wearing on his left arm? So that looks like a contraption for tendonitis. A lot of glass blowers or tennis elbow. You know, this is a job where you do a lot of repetitive motion. So there is wear and tear on the body, especially when you start making larger and larger pieces. Lower back, shoulders, wrists, it does take its toll on your body. But a skilled glass blower, again, you learn how to work with the glass, move with the glass, so that you're not constantly fighting the material. Yeah. Yeah, so Kat is being a lovely assistant. Yeah. She is guarding Darin's wrist from the radiant heat. Some glass blowers will put on a sleeve made out of Nomex or, you know, Kevlar, that type of thing, just a protective barrier between the glass and the sense. I don't know. I know they, like, when you prepare a bottle for a baby, you pour a little milk here to make sure that it's, no, not too hot, because that's a tender part of your wrist, right? So it does tend to overheat. I've seen people get some pretty bad blisters from not wearing a sleeve. Just their skin isn't either used to it, or they're just too close to the glass itself. Radiant burns are, in my opinion, more common than burning yourself on the glass or burning yourself on a tool that's been used to shape the glass. You know, common sense says the glass came out of a 2,000 degree Fahrenheit furnace. Don't touch it, right? Don't touch it. Maybe don't touch a tool that's touched the hot glass because it's going to be hot. Some people won't even, you know, some people like to use the marver as a sofa, but some people also know that the marver or metal table at the center of the stage can be hot. It all depends on how much glass has been used on it, how long that glass has sat there. So cooling the glass down so that you can get another gathering. You can use the compressed air if you'd like. Yeah, how long does it keep the heat? The glass will stay hot depending on how thin or thick it is. This is a pretty thick amount of glass. We saw the walls of the two cups that were joined. Now he has another layer of glass on top of that. And don't forget, we're gathering on this piece two more times. So the walls of this piece are going to be fairly thick. That means it will stay hotter for longer. The thinner the glass is, the faster it cools. But with that said, this piece tonight will never drop below 900 degrees Fahrenheit. That's the tipping point. If it cools down too quickly below that point, it will crack and break. Our glass, soda lime glass, even though it's premium spectrum, it is very susceptible to thermal shock. So unlike a borosilicate glass, which Pyrex used to be made out of, or you know, a lot of lamp workers, flame workers use, that can go from room temperature to 4,000 degrees Fahrenheit in a second without cracking and breaking. Soda lime glass is very different. It's a different beast to work with. You can see Darin has put on a protective, reflective, very shiny sleeve. These are really nice. They'll protect his arm. Feel like an astronaut over there? There we go. Be careful. Don't break the amphitheater. What do you all think of that? And we did have another question about the dimple in the glass. That is clear glass pushing into the layer of white glass underneath of it. It is simply magnification of the layers of glass that we're applying to this. That dimple, or what appears to be a dimple, will go away as he starts to stretch the form into what he wants. So don't worry about it. It will go away. You can see on his form, I mean, the white, it is going to be the underneath and the neck part. So even if there was a little imperfection like that, he could hide it. How heavy is that? It's going to be, I'm going to say, 1,200 pounds. Darin's super strong. I don't know. I'm guessing with another layer of glass on top of this, it's going to be about 15 pounds. But remember, this is 15 pounds off the end of a 5-foot metal pipe. When the glass gets hot, it's not sitting still like a bowling ball sits still. It's kicking and screaming. So, you know, a toddler that's having a tantrum, you can hold them close and try and calm them down. This is a toddler off the end of a 5-foot pole that you have to turn and keep calm. So it will fight him, especially as you get more hot glass and that core starts to reheat, which is the goal. We need heat to get back into the core in order for it to move around and become the sculpture or the lek that Darin wants. Yeah. One second. Yep. How are they going to make it bigger? They made it get bigger by getting more glass. So they collected glass, and then they're going to make it even bigger by blowing into the blowpipe. You were at the Don't Try This at Home show, right? Or the Beyond the Bench, too? Yep. So did you see us blow up a really big bubble? Yeah? Yep. Darin's not going to do that. But he'll still blow through the blowpipe and make this bubble larger. Yeah, question here. The blocks that we use are made out of cherry wood. I've seen blocks made out of apple. Any fruit wood works. It takes a long time for fruit woods to grow, so the grain is very dense and concentrated. That means in the dry tools, it's going to burn away nice and evenly. In the wet tools, it holds the water for a long time. And it has little to no sap or resin. That would leave dirty, ugly, scuzzy marks on the surface of the glass. Steuben is being made locally on a very small scale. It is stewarded by Corning, and they will be releasing small designs here and there, year to year, but it will never be what it once was when it was in this building. Small design, small little batches of it. Yeah, so it was repurchased by Corning. We're stewarding it, and there are small designs, or small batches of Steuben that will be available. With that said, on Market Street, you know, there's a Steuben store owned by a local. You could see some of the older Steuben stuff. Even just walking down the street, if she's not open, you can see some really beautiful pieces of Steuben. All right, George, right now, just for those of you curious, behind Darin, he is raking the clear glass. This is kind of like a big metal spatula. He's pushing any bubbles or impurities that happen in the furnace to the back so that they don't get caught up in Darren's bubble. Go big or go home. I like that thought. Is everyone ready? Are you ready? Here we go. I wish the glass would stay that color sometimes. Yeah. Now that is a beautiful and a very large gather. I mean, take a look at that gather line I mentioned earlier on in the demonstration. It is still straight, right? It's not wavy at all. Huh? Keep breathing. Don't forget to breathe. Go a larger block. So that glass, you know, it's hot, but it still has magnifying properties. We are looking through a convex lens right now, right? It's a convex surface. So it's going to magnify everything that's underneath of it. They are going, any texture that you see underneath that clear later will go away as he starts to inflate the glass and manipulate it further. So this piece will start to get bigger. I'm I'm going to keep a half an ear, all my ears open, in case I need to get back onto the stage. How are we doing with questions? Doing okay out there? It is amazing. It's really beautiful, too. I mean, there is no material like glass in the world, in my opinion. Of course, there's resins and polyurethane stuff that they can cast with or that type of thing, but there's just nothing that you can layer colors like glass. You can be an artist, but you can also be a chemist, or you know, you can gravitate towards making your own equipment or tools. You can make your own color if you get into that side of the world. There's so many different paths that you can take as a glass person. There he goes, blowing. A very gentle, even pressure. As the glass cools, you use more and more pressure. The more glass there is, you use a little more pressure. Now specifically cooling off the tip of the bubble using our marvering table. This is about an inch thick stainless steel. So it is a big heat sink. He's cooling down the tip so you can start to inflate the shoulders or the glass that's attached to the blowpipe. The glass that is furthest away from Darin at this point is going to become the bottom or the base of his lek. Oh, it's always nice to have a strong, sturdy foundation. You don't want the bubble to shoot straight out to the bottom of the glass, otherwise he'll have no glass for a base or a foot. You can see that the infamous dimple is going to go away as he blows into the blowpipe. You know, we've had a lot of amazing pieces of glass come out of this hot shop, including this lek that will be made. You know, these are things you don't get to see every day. This is a craft or an art form that isn't quite made like this. This is a one-of-a-kind piece. You know, Darin can remake these and make many of them, but each one is going to be unique. Maybe he won't ever use Spectrum again, because that's what we melt here. At a different studio, he'll use a different type of glass, which will move differently. He may switch up the color, but you know, glass just really isn't made a lot like this nowadays. That's what makes our demonstrations so very special. This piece, I believe, will belong to Darin. It's up to him what he will do with it. I know we try and do a really good job at posting the picture of the final form on Facebook. So if you haven't got enough glass, you know, maybe think about becoming a member or signing up for our newsletter. You'll get notifications on when we do live streams like this. So no matter where you are in the world, you can watch us make glass here on special occasions. So right now we have a lot of people joining us on YouTube. We have a live stream on our Facebook page and on the museum's website as well. On YouTube, you know, you can find a lot of wonderful videos, whether it's artists working or it's informative and educational. They do videos across the street at the studio. So Darin is a featured teacher. He is teaching a class over at the studio. Where a lot of world-renowned artists come to learn and teach classes. So he has teaching a class all week. You know, a couple weeks ago, we had Martin Janetsky. We had a lot of great artists come through this summer making some beautiful pieces of work. So the Corning Museum of Glass itself is set up in three main buildings. We're in the building with the collection and demonstrations. Across the parking lot, there's a studio where glassblowers take classes or teach, and you can make your own glass at the Make Your Own Workshop that's across the way. Then behind that, we have a third building, the Raykow Research Library, which if you are around tomorrow, Those red tags, remember, get you in, but they have another exhibit over there. It's called Curious and Curiouser, and there's some staff favorites. So we've gone through our collection and picked out some oddities and put them on display. There's romance novels written about glassblowers. There's a Mark Pizer piece. I mentioned him earlier on in the show. A casting. But a lot of interesting things that they have found throughout our collection. I think at one point there was a costume that was worn by Elton John. I might jump in here. He is blowing. Yeah, so this is a great way for the glassblower to shape from the inside and the outside all at once. Aaron is inflating. George is helping to turn. Darin is watching the glass, making sure it's moving exactly how he wants it to. And so really a team effort. I think, you know, that's an... we mentioned earlier that you really have to use your entire body when you're making pieces of glass, especially to this size. But it becomes a team effort as well. You know, it's a great way to work with your friends. You know, typically, when we're in the hot shop, we like loud music. We know what the glassblower, the gaffer, or Darin at this point, what he wants. The path he's going to take to create the piece he wants successfully. Oh, just like a sport that you might play, you know, you depend a lot on your team. And of course, the more you practice, the better it's going to be. Look. How many hours will this anneal for? Darin, how long are you going to anneal this? I'm here.
Oh, hey.
Hey. I came back for you. 32 hours, which is a good amount of time. I've seen pieces of glass that have been annealed in 4. Make glass in the morning for 4 hours, shut the annealer off, let it cool down to room temperature over another 4 hours. Nope, sorry, George. All depends on the thickness of the glass. How thick is the walls? Oh, you said that much. About an inch, maybe, a little less. Growling at the glass helps. It definitely does. Those beeswax you saw coming off of the jacks. Remember how much experience you're watching right now. Darin with about 25 years of experience, George with 28. Aaron has over 20 years of experience. Which really becomes very handy, especially with George backing up. That it looks like it's easy, but it's not. You know, if George staggered right now, he could throw the piece off center. He's watching Darin, watching the glass, being super observant, making sure that he's turning at a very specific rate so that Darin can shape. Now he's also, when George is turning, he's pushing down, right? We've created a pivot point off of the bench. The glass is fairly heavy, so it can pull down towards the ground and lift the back end of the blowpipe up off of the bench arms. So it helps, really helps to have a little muscle on the back end and hold the glass down so it's not sliding and bouncing all over the place. A little bit of gravity elongating the form. And talk about optics and how it affects what you're seeing from the shot that we have on the screens right now. There's a good inch and a half of glass off the tip of the bubble, and it's playing with that line you see between the two cups. Our reheating furnaces here, they're running a little hotter at 2,300 degrees Fahrenheit. We've got these barn doors on them so we can protect George from the heat while he's turning. Of course, the third set of doors opens up as well. Now we have a larger furnace up here on the stage to make larger pieces of glass. It's one of the largest furnaces that I know of. It's about almost 6 feet deep and almost 3 feet wide in diameter. Now they've made a life-size child out of glass from that furnace. There's been a life-size sea turtle, all by world-renowned artists. All right, this is another reason why Darin is wearing that glove. This is where he's pulling the point. Another reason to leave a good amount of clear glass off the end. Can manipulate it further. All right, I have a moment. Did you folks have any questions? I'm up here. One second. It is, I can't hear you over that. What's your question? Yeah, what's the difficulty level of this piece compared to another piece? It's like 1 to 10. Darin, how difficult is this piece on a scale of 1 to 10? 11. That's a good one. Good. Yeah, look. Yeah, so he said the colors, they don't like to behave. The black is really soft, the white's really stiff. It's going to really play a big role in the shape and the size. Is large. Yeah, it's demanding. That's a good way to describe it, yeah. Well, this is a good stance out of the bench here. Allows him to see the glass. Now we have this, I don't know, we have a protective metal barrier on our bench, but sometimes it gets in the way. So he can kind of straddle the bench arm and get out where he needs to be to shape the glass. A lek, yeah, the lek is, now I forgot, the lek, that's a series. It's a bird, I believe. It's a bird. I know, talking to Darin before the show, these are bird-like creatures that have body language. So when, you know, birds communicate with one another, some will spread their plumage like a peacock, some will strut around, you know, like paradise bird. But every bird has their own body language. And this is something that speaks to Darin because humans have their own body language too, depending on who you're talking to. What's he going to do now? Oh, look at you. Who knows? He's a man of mystery. Jacks. So he's going. Oh, lumberjacks. He's got parchofies out. Lumberjacks. Some short. No, he's not going to put it on his leg. It does look like he's about to bounce his knee up in there and shape the glass with his knee, but he's not. That jacket on his leg is going to protect him from the heat. Yeah. If we look at the drawing, looks like this might become the neck and where, yeah. Again, I've never watched Darin make one of these. Neither of you. Oh, I bet he didn't know that. A lek is also the currency in Albania.
That's funny, I get money from Albania for this.
You get money from Albania for this? Leck. I won't sing along with you. I deafen people. Yeah. All right, so Darin, that's the head. Must be. And then I'll start to pull. So just... Oh, that's what you were singing. Animaniacs. I gotcha. I just couldn't hear you. It looks like he's working on this part. This head part right now. Probably stretch and pull it. Thank you. That part up here is what he's working on right now. This is close to the final form. Each one is different, it looks like, from the pictures that I've seen online. If we look closely, he's not... You know, George is backing up. He's watching Darren's hands. He's not making full rotations, and that's because of the colors. He's fighting that against the black while the white stays stiff. So he might hit the black a couple more times than the white to cool it down faster and try and even out that temperature. I think some of the most interesting pieces are not functional. They're just, yeah. Like this one. Yeah. This is Lex for Lex. Albanian money. You notice it goes back and forth between, you know, where the glass is attached to the blowpipe and where he wants the glass to move. Remember earlier I said if the glass cools too quickly, it'll crack and break. I don't think he'll allow it to get too cold, but the moil or the glass that's attached to the blowpipe can crack. So that torch will help manage the temperature. I feel like it's safe for me to join you again. So go ahead and wave and get my attention. Welcome to those of you joining us on our live stream. If you're just joining us, this is Darin Denison making a lek, a bird figure form that speaks to the body language of both birds and humans. Right. If you have any questions online, feel free to ask. We've got Amanda here answering questions, and if she can't answer them, I will be happy to. When Darin goes for this move on the neck, you can see he's really focusing the heat on the white because he knows the black is going to heat up and move for him when he's inside of the furnace. He may have Frederick or Aaron blow when he stretches. This is a really long, stretched out neck. He may have someone blow or cap the air in the pipe so he'll keep it from collapsing, concaving. It'll keep it in a nice tube. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So before the show, Darin took some clear glass out of the furnace and cut through it and tweezed it and made a beautiful sculpture. That was the pre-show. Just kidding. He was probably cleaning his tools. So we have a toolbox over here, you know, in his toolbox. Tools can bang around, touch each other, get wax on the tweezers, that type of thing. So tweezing on the using molten glass is another way to clean the tools. Yeah. You can see that neck really starting to move around. You can see the color difference. Remember, that's the temperature difference. This is all just really working heat back into the piece where Darin wants it to move around and allowing other parts of the piece to cool down and stabilize. So a couple of heats in our furnace to really help. Hear George asking what side the white should be facing. He's leaving the bench. It looks like something. Yes, it sounds like something is going to go down. Here he goes. Darin's back on the pipe. Usually when the gaffer, George is up on the marver. Oh, I'll answer that question in a second. That's a good one. I'm not sure, but
We should focus on the wonder that is George Kennard up on the Marver. And Darin getting the glass hot. So I know that, look at that, George on the Marver. You're gonna move, here it comes out. Gravity. Making sure he does this at just the right time. There we go, that'll help. There's the neck. What do you all think? Really, that final shaping, it's a lot of work and effort goes into the color pattern, and then it's the last, it really is the last 30 seconds that tells you whether you're going to make it or if it's all going to end up on the floor. It was really a beautiful form. You know, not only the piece itself, but that negative space between the head and the body. It is, yeah. You know, it's a... It can go in. Pretty important that it goes back into that furnace, right? Yeah, it's the piece can't go back into the furnace, then it needs to go into an oven or an anneler very quickly. There are only a certain amount of size restraints that we have, and that are the furnaces, the furnace doors, the annealing space, which we would never run out of, annealing space or slow cooling ovens. We have 13 annealers here in the Amphitheater Hot Shop. Some of them are large enough to accommodate people, so we'll never run out of space to cool the glass down. One of the questions was, what does the team like that Darin normally works with? I'll ask him in a second. I don't think he has his own studio. He might. But the team I've always seen Darin work on is with Lino Tagliapietro. And they have Darin, David, Jen, and Lino. That's like the core team. Typically, you will see glassblowers work in groups of three. But of course, this piece is larger, so we'll need more people. The larger the piece, the more technically difficult or the more sculptural aspects you put on that piece, the more people you will need to help out. Darin, do you have your own shop? Do you have your own studio? No.
Like
traveling and vacation. You know what? I agree with you. There's a lot of commitment to a studio and it's more than six kids. And so he's going to clean up that beak with a point there. Because he's pulling it at a very specific angle, clipping it. So he likes, I heard him say, I'm going to keep that on there. I think he likes how it's rested. What's that? Oh, yeah. It's just barely touched there. He's using the torch to make sure it stays touched, or he might remove where it has touched back onto itself. Does it has its own unique gesture, doesn't it? Exactly what Darin was aiming for, is body language, right? Gorgeous. All right, so remember, this is going to cool down over 32 hours. And we try and post pictures of these pieces when they're finished up on the Facebook page. Yeah. No. Yeah, so we have these large black boxes on either side of the stage. Those are annealers, slow cooling ovens. Right now, the annealer that Darin is going to go in is at 900 degrees Fahrenheit. Maybe even 910. And then it soaks the glass. So when glass cools down, it shrinks a little bit. If we let this piece sit out in the open air, the surface that's exposed to the air would cool down faster than the core of the walls. So the surface would shrink faster than the core, which would pull the piece apart from strain. To alleviate the strain from the creation process, we put the glass in an annealer where it will soak all to the same temperature. The surface, the skinny neck will be the same temperature as the thicker base, right? So then it will slowly step down in temperature. Since this is a 32-hour cycle, 100 degrees every few hours. I make sure I know which oven they're going into. So it'll be this top annealer here on our far end of the stage. They're going to slowly start to kind of manually even out the temperatures. Looks like Aaron is getting ready. Jacket's here. Aaron is going to suit up in PPE, personal protective equipment. He'll be able to catch this piece practically in his hands. He'll also look like a spaceman for a few moments. So we do have a full hood that he could put on, but since this annealer is on top, all that heat's going to escape up. Aaron's face will be fairly comfortable The face shield, obviously, is still pretty important. Aaron likes his hair the way it is. So he'll protect it with a face shield. Now, these bottom annealers down here, if you're walking up to that annealer and you want to put a piece of glass in, that heat will rush out directly into your face. So I don't know if you've ever baked cookies and had your face in the wrong place when you open up the oven to check on the cookies. What your oven is at 375 degrees Fahrenheit, probably. Right? It's still very hot on your face. So the lower annealers intend to kind of push a little more hot air. Two more. So, where the glass is going to break off of the blowpipe, it will be sharp, but you know we can cold work that or chop that part off and make it a nice flat base, which that's the noise it makes. Meow. So there's we can work the glass out of a furnace, hot work it, cold work it, warm work the glass by fusing and slumping in different ovens. There's really this whole world to the material. You know, everybody's path is unique. They take their own path, whether it's cold working, hot working, torch working. Here we go. This is for you. Last flash. Just heard Darin say that this was the baby one. There we go. Aaron's getting ready. Aaron, would you like both doors? Frederick, grab one of these doors. I'm going to make sure that Aaron is comfortable. It would be a shame to hit an annealer door with this piece of glass. So we'll make sure he has plenty of room. Here we go. Tap. Get it back in. All right, there we have it. Beautiful piece by Darin Denison. And team. Look, a standing ovation. Very nice. Thank you all for joining us. It was wonderful. Now,